This is going to suck. I've completely forgotten how to do this program. It's been so long. Oh, wait a second. I forgot. Just in case something like this happened, I produced this small tome on how to produce the show. I'm saved. Planning ahead. Let's see. Step one, look intently into the camera. Say as sincerely as you can, we've got a very special program for you tonight. We've got a very special program for you tonight. No, wait. That's not right. That's Ham Nation. That's when I was doing Ham Nation. This is for Ham Radio Now. They're kind of stuck on the, it's a special program every week. But you can't blame that. You can't blame them. Lots of shows do that. Even Jon Stewart does that on, what is that show? The Daily Show. Every show is a very special show with a very special guest. How do we do Ham Radio Now? Step one, stare blankly into the camera. Step two, announce the episode number. Oh, I don't remember what the episode number is. Let's see, 156 was propagation way back on June 25th. So this must be 157. What was that again? Announce the episode number. Ham Radio Now, episode 157. Step three, duck. Duck. Forgot about that. And announce the episode title. I have no idea. I'm here. That'll be the title. I'm back. And then step five, do the show. So, okay. Where have we been? I got some email I need to show you. This is from Arnie, K5ARN, SA7CAR. Gary, you need to be on the air soon to promote the Kickstarter project. I think with new episodes and your promotion on QRZ.com, Twitter and email will draw more contributors. Time is running out. I did this. Wait a minute. This camera will show it better. Time is running out. You couldn't see that when I was showing the email. Maybe you already have promises from corporate sponsors to reach your goal. Whoa, no. No, we don't. Well, actually, we're closer. Closer than I expected to be with no promotion from me. And he was wondering what was going on. And I explained a little bit about what's happening. And I put a little bit of this on the web, but I haven't really spent very much time. Timing couldn't be worse for a huge influx of freelance work. And indeed, I have went out to field day with Jeff. We had a great time and shot a lot of stuff at W3AO, who turns out was actually operating as W1AW, Portable 3. And we looked at several other field day operations in the area, some, none as big as them. I think there were 26A this year. So none that big, but some bigger and some smaller. And then came back and drove back on Sunday night. And on Monday morning, I went to my biggest freelance client. They had installed a brand new editing system. I think I've got a picture of that on my phone. Yeah, there it is. There's the new editing system. It's not real fancy, but it's all new equipment, and I had a lot to learn. And as soon as I got the basics under my belt, it's an audio editing system, they came up with like four big projects in a row. For the past 3 weeks, I've done nothing but freelance work all day. Late enough into the evening that by the time I got home and had dinner, it was too late to do anything serious. And I was tired. Yeah, I'm old. You know, I don't have that kind of stamina that the young kids have. So that's what I've been doing. That's why you haven't heard from me. That's why there have been no episodes on the air. Very good for the Ham Radio Now. Well, for my bank account. Ham Radio Now doesn't get any of that anymore. and my own bank account has not been doing all that well. The other thing I had to do was the quarterly taxes. So once a quarter, I spend a whole day doing the taxes for my business, Pierce 10 Inc. And I also paid myself for the second time this year. I have paid myself a grand total of $10,000 this year. That's 6 months worth of a year, $10,000. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do that for the next two quarters or not. If I do, that'll be $20,000 that I paid myself. And I have to take taxes out of that because I'm a business, a corporation. So I don't get even all of that money. How many of you guys are making $20,000 a year? A few of you guys are making less than that, and you've actually sent me contributions. That's pretty awesome. But most of you, I suspect, are making a little bit more. Back to Arnie. I sent him a note that said, this will be the first week since field day without being fully committed to outside projects. I intend to get several programs produced, but first the business taxes are overdue. And still didn't get anything done. The freelance stuff did not stop. I spent a day doing the taxes, and then the freelance stuff picked up again. So that's good. Maybe I can pay myself next quarter. Arnie continues, having several years of Tapper conferences online. Oh, he was asking, he's thinking about going to Austin for the Tapper and DCC. I guess he's never been to one. It says the conference is for everyone with an interest in digital communications, from beginner to expert. He's a beginner, so he might qualify. He's got to watch out for the scheduling because he's got a wedding to go to. So I have some advice for Arnie and for anybody else who's thinking about going to the DCC. What I explained to him was that it is not a three-day training course on how to do digital. Having the episodes online and being able to go back and watch several years' worth will give you a very good idea, if you haven't watched any of them, of what things are being presented. The schedule has not been released for this year, although it should be released pretty soon. So you can see what kind of talks are going to be at the conference. But it is not a three-day training conference on how to do ham radio digital. Each subject is pretty much self-contained for about a 40-minute talk. Some of them are more technical than others. Some of them are way, way over my head. Some of them are hardly technical at all, more operational. But most of them are more technical. And you probably won't get a lot out of them if you are complete beginner. They do have a track of introductory sessions, and those are very introductory, but you're starting from scratch, usually on 4 or 5 or 6 topics, depending on how many people they can get to prepare those talks. What's missing, and missing is the wrong word, because it's not like there should be something there and there's not. That it is what they promise it is. What is not in between is, kind of the bridge between just getting started and the level of the talks that you're going to be watching if you watch the main set of talks. I don't know where to go to do that in-between stuff. I'm sure there are resources, but I'm not familiar with them. But again, if you're wondering whether to go or not, you still got plenty of time to make arrangements to go, and they'd love to have you there. There's some really good reasons to be there in person, even though the programs will be on have been on video and will be if this Kickstarter is successful. The reason to go is if you see in the schedule 2 or 3 or 4 talks that are on subjects that are of particular interest to you, not only do you get to watch the talk and not have to wait a month or 2 or 3 for it to show up online, you get to talk to the guy who did the presentation and ask questions. Ask questions in the forum, and then they'll be in the demo room and at dinner and hanging around in the hallways. Plenty of opportunity to talk to them and ask your specific question and talk to other people who are interested in the same thing and asking questions as well. So that is the reason to go. That's one of the reasons to go. The other is just the camaraderie and the general level of attention that you can get when you're actually there in person. So look at this, at the talks that get scheduled, and decide if that's something that you want to go see. about 100 to last year in Seattle, I think it was a record, about almost 150, around 150 people were there. Austin is another one of those hotbeds of technology, like Seattle is. And looking forward to seeing a pretty substantial number of people showing up in person. So that was my advice to Arnie. That's my advice to you. I don't know if that would be Tapper's specific advice, but from my experience, having been there for like 5 years, that's what I've seen. And from the experience of someone who's not very technical, I have the advantage when I'm editing these programs of watching them over and over and over again in little increments as I'm editing. So I tend to learn something. You probably don't have time to watch the programs in that much detail. But if you see something that you're really fascinated by, you can take a look. So thank you, Arnie. Maybe we will see you there if you decide to go, and if I can get myself there, courtesy of you guys and the Kickstarter. So let's take a look at that Kickstarter. And kaboom, with no input from me other than launching it, before field day, just before field day, it's halfway there, and about halfway through, 15 days to go or 14 days to go at a little over $4,000 from the $8,000 goal. Now, let me say a couple things about that. First, the launch. I was notified that the Kickstarter folks had accepted the project, expected them to, but until they accept it, you can't tell it to go. So Jeff and I were driving up to Virginia, and I was at a rest stop on I-95, and I looked at my phone, and there was the email from the Kickstarter folks saying, your project has been accepted. You can launch it whenever you want. And having done a couple of these before, I knew I was ready. Everything was prepared. It was time to push the go button. So sitting, should I say this? Oh, why not? Sitting on the John at the rest stop on I-95, on my phone, pushed the go button, and the Kickstarter was launched. And that's the last thing I did. Well, I went to the old Kickstarter and notified all of the people that had supported last year's Tapper Kickstarter that this year's was up and running. And they have sort of taken it from there, and it's been climbing. Let's see. What does this tell you? I see more than you do. There are, for $10 backers, there's 14 of those, 25 bucks, 16, $50, there's 10 of them. Let me zoom in a little bit. 100 bucks, 6 backers, that's pretty cool. 150, there are 4 backers. $500, that's my new level, and that was designed for small businesses, and there's 3 backers already, and I haven't gone hunting for anybody. I know one of them is Adam Curry, who does the No Agenda show with John C. Dvorak. KF5SLN, I think is his call sign. I want to get Adam on the show. He said he would go on the show sometime with me. He's moving right now, so it's a bad time to ask him, but I'll see if I can get him on sometime. I think that would be fun and very scary for me because he tends to rip people to shreds, although he likes hams, and he's been posting a lot of stuff on Twitter and even talking on his No Agenda show about getting on D-Star and talking to Dvorak on D-Star. So if you listen to D-Star, I think they've been on 14, either 33 or 14 with 2 reflectors that he's showed up on. And I forget which letter that was part of. Go look at his Twitter feed. He'll find it. Or listen to the show. He'll talk about it. After the show, sometimes he takes comments on D-Star. So that will be pretty cool. So clearly he's getting active. He's talked about getting stuff set up in his car. Not one of those celebrities that gets a ham license and then just kind of sits on it, like some celebrities who got ham license that we know that I won't mention. Leo. Let's see, where are we? So 3 of the 500s are gone, and I'm limited it to 6. Nobody's signed up for the 2000s yet. And last year, it was Flex and Elecraft that did the 2000s, along with Tapper itself. I'd like to keep Tapper out of it this year. They don't really have the money to be supporting this. They have better things to do with their money. But if we get 2 of the three available $2,000, well, we're there, you know, because we're at 4,000. So that would be 8,000. Now, I would like to get more than $8,000. If I do, and last year this didn't work out so well, but if I get more, I will do my best to spend a little more time on the road and line up a few things somewhere between Austin and Raleigh, North Carolina, and stop and see some folks who do interesting things. Reasonably, we might do two of those things. Now, Flex itself is in Austin, and they are sponsoring the DCC itself as well. They're doing a lot of the logistics and helping get things set up for the DCC. And whether they, if I get out there, whether they've sponsored the video or not, I'll see about stopping by their place. And I mean, there's videos online about what Flex does, but I don't think there's a really good factory tour. So maybe we can take a look at that. We'll see. There's other interesting stuff going on around Texas and in between there and here. So we'll see what we can do. So the thing you can do right now, I've got to spend a day contacting some small businesses and letting them know this is here. But you can do that too. If you know a small ham radio business that does something that you think would be of interest and value to the folks who participate in Tapper and or enjoy the DCC videos, let them know they can get their name associated with this. I call it underwriting. They'd get a 10-second mention at the top of each program that they helped get the video produced. As for the $2,000, that takes a bigger company. If you want to talk to the folks at Flex and Elecraft and say, sure, I'm glad you did it last year. Sure would like to see you do it again this year. Wouldn't hurt. But if you know some other big company that you think ought to participate in something like this, let them know. If you want me to do it, let me know. I'll see what I can do. Anything else on that? I don't think so. I think we're pretty much done on that. If you would like to support the Kickstarter yourself, there's still an unlimited number of the $10, $25, $50, $100, and $150 contributions are accepted. So no limit on those. And you get some stuff. It's not great, but you get some stuff. Okay, so what else have I got here? Well, the other big thing that's going on is this congressional bill. It is H.R. 4969, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. Pretty good chance you already have an idea what that's all about. Basically, it takes PRB1. Have you ever seen what PRB1 actually looks like? This is PRB1 as it exists in the actual rules, and it's in Part 97, the Ham Radio Rules, Part 97.15, Paragraph B. A station antenna structure may be erected at heights and dimensions sufficient to accommodate amateur service communications. State and local regulation, this is the big part, state and local regulation of an antenna structure must not preclude amateur service communications. Rather, it must reasonably accommodate such communications and must constitute the minimum practicable regulation to accomplish a state or local authority's legitimate purpose. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. Vague, but when we were doing the Gary Wadke antenna story, the attorney we were talking to said, no, that language in the hands of the right attorney is pretty ironclad. Well, tell it to the judge. Some judges have agreed and some have not, but he said it should get you through. So the problem has been that applies to state and local regulation. And a far more serious problem for most hams is not the state and local regulation. I mean, that can be a problem, your county, your city, but it's your subdivision, your homeowners association. We're getting more and more of those. I live in a homeowners association area, getting more and more of those. When I was a kid back in the 60s, we stuck antennas up on the roof. Some of the neighbors weren't real happy about it. Most of them didn't seem to care very much. But we didn't think twice about it. We didn't ask anybody. We just did it. Spend another couple of decades, and now I'm, you know, buying houses myself and discovering that some have homeowners associations. I bought one, a townhouse in the suburban Chicago, and this would have been in the mid-70s, and was somewhat surprised to discover that there was a homeowners association that had rules about antennas. So I dug into that a little bit more and found out that, well, there was a homeowners association. It was defunct. It didn't have any officers. It didn't meet. It had no one to enforce the regulations. So I stuck up antennas and nobody complained. But here in the suburb of Raleigh, Cary, North Carolina, the concentrated area of relocated Yankees, y'all, there's aren't very many places that don't have antenna restrictions based on codes, covenants, and restrictions, CCNRs, the stuff from the Homeowners Association. Jeff actually lives in one of those neighborhoods that doesn't. It's an old neighborhood. He bought his house in the 70s, and he doesn't have any restrictions, so he puts up antennas at will. This neighborhood where I live was a brand new neighborhood when we moved in. The builder was the Homeowners Association at that time, and when Cindy and I were negotiating to buy the house, we put in, we made a proposal, a presentation, showing the kind of antennas I wanted to put up. Some dipoles and some pretty low-profile verticals on the roof, mobile whips basically on the roof. We talked to them about a beam, HF beam, little tower, things like that. None of that was going to fly, but the dipoles and the little antenna work. So far, I've got a dipole up, one of the three that I specified, and no antennas on the roof. My VHF antenna this is pretty sad. That magnet mount there, and there's another magnet mount back there. I've only been here 6 years. Takes time. Gosh, 7 years. All right, so what's the deal? Well, I want to do a program about this in more detail with some more people who know a lot about it. But at least for now, this bill is in Congress, and who knows what's going to happen with it. You know, that's one of the things I want to talk about. But ham radio bills have been introduced in Congress frequently over the past couple of decades. They have all died in committee. They've never made it to actual law. But last year, the ARL asked, ARL has been asking the FCC to preempt local codes, covenants, and restrictions for a long time. And the FCC finally laid it on the line. They said, no, we're not going to do that. If you want that kind of change, go to Congress. That's where the decision needs to be made. So the ARL went to Congress and some friendly lawmakers, and Congress basically said, what we'll do is we will tell the FCC to do a study and then give us the results of the study and see if you all really have a problem. So they did that. And the FCC got the congressional mandate to do a study, and they did the study, and we filed all kinds of comments, and the ARL filed all kinds of comments and said, we are hurt pretty bad by this codes, covenants, and restrictions thing. They are spreading across the land, and we are either completely frozen out of putting up antennas, or it's very difficult. We're forced out into rural territories or old neighborhoods, things that if ham radio is the only thing you're considering, well, you might do that. But if you've got other considerations in your life, your job, commute, things like that, schools, the places you want to live are either you're not going to be able to live there, or you're not going to be putting up ham radio antennas. So we made that case. And the FCC's report to Congress said, we don't think they got such a problem. It ain't that bad. They had some nice things about it. We did a show about this last winter. They had some nice things to say about us, but as far as the antennas were concerned, they said, no. So ARL went back to Congress and said, forget about it. We still want our relief from CCNRs. And they found some friendly legislators who came up with this bill. It is in Congress. It's not in the Senate yet at this point, but it is HR 4969, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And I think I've got here what that really says. Okay, this is the bill. And there's a fair amount of blah, blah, blah. We're wonderful, we're wonderful, we're wonderful. We don't cost anything and we're wonderful. And let's see, here's the actual language. Not later than 120 days after the date of enactment of this act, the Federal Communications Commission shall amend Section 97.15B of Title 47, Code of Federal Regulations, that's what I showed you a minute ago, so that such section prohibits application to the amateur radio service of any private land use restriction, including a restrictive covenant that precludes such communications. In other words, let's say you can't put up any antenna, or fails to reasonably accommodate such communications, or does not constitute the minimum practicable restriction on such communications to accomplish the legitimate purpose of the private entity. That would be you and me. That would be the homeowners association of the private entity seeking to enforce such restrictions. I'm not very good at reading the legal stuff. So it's basically taking what's in PRB1 and in Part 97 and making it apply to your private contracts. So yay. What the ARL wants you to do now is communicate with your congressman person and gin up support for this bill. And they've got this page here. It'll be easy to find it right off of their website. And that's probably going to be there for a while. Off the homepage of their website, you'll see this stuff. And this is the basic steps to follow. Find out what it's all about, what it will do, which is pretty short. Find your congressman. Here's what you can do to get it passed. And what they're asking you to do is to write a letter, but not to send the letter to your congressman. They want you to send the letter to the ARL. And they explain why. It's got to do with the way mail is being diverted for security. So if they get it and they deliver them all together, it'll get to the congressperson faster. And then here's the only part that I've got a problem with, the talking points. There's a lot here. And I don't really know how much you want to say. The simpler you can keep it, the shorter you can keep it, the better. So you can look at all this stuff and get the points that you want to put into it. But if you can keep it short, you're probably better off, because they're only going to read so much and probably not all of that stuff. So I'm going to see if I can put together one of the BS sessions and talk to some people who know what's going on. They've been watching ham radio for a long time and paying very careful attention, especially in the legislative arena. And we'll see if this is something that is just, nice pat on the head to us, but like so many bills for special interests in Congress, not really going to go anywhere, or whether it's got a shot. It is going to a committee chaired by Greg Walden, whose call sign I forget, but he's the only ham in Congress, and he's the chairman of it's one of the communications subcommittees. So it's not likely that the bill will go there to die, because I don't think he would let it die, just get left on the shelf and never brought up and discussed and debated or whatever. I also have no idea who the opposition would be. I don't know how. I mean, it's introduced bipartisan, a Democrat and a Republican. People have been saying, especially the liberal media has been saying, this is a do-nothing Congress, that they haven't really gotten very much done. And so many different things can happen in to a bill in terms of legislation. It can be attached to another one. It can be made an amendment. I mean, that's how we got the first thing going to the FCC to say, do this study. You know, that was attached to something else as an amendment that had nothing to do with communications or ham radio or anything else. I think it was a payroll something or other. I forget. But absolutely nothing to do with it. But that's the way Congress works. So that's why I want the experts to talk to me about how this might go down. Assuming that it gets through this Congress, through the House, it has to get a companion bill in the Senate. They have to have the same language eventually, you know, hammered out together and passed by both bodies and then signed by the president. And that's the way it works. You remember, I'm just a bill on Capitol Hill. Can I find that?
Woo, you sure got to climb a lot of steps to get to this Capitol building here in Washington. Well, I wonder who that sad little scrap of paper is.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill.
Oh, that is wonderful. You ought to, go look that up. I don't know, and it's only 3 minutes long, so I don't know. You may learn something, and you may not. I don't know, but that's the idea. So there's a lot of hoops to jump through. There is one more video that I would like to at least get started, and that is from our ARL president, Kay Craigie, and she has a message for the troops about doing this. So, again, I'll only play a little bit of it.
Hi, I'm Kay Craigie, N3KN, president of the ARRL. And I'd like to ask for a few minutes of your time today to get you to help thousands of radio amateurs around the country get the chance to put up antennas at their home locations.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. I'm relatively lucky, although I would like to put up more antenna than I negotiated, you know, right now. Although I don't have as many antennas up as I originally negotiated, but I'd still like the opportunity to put up more. Maybe I'd feel more incented to do that. So we will try to find some more people to talk to about that. We'll do a BS session. That and other stuff that's been going on in ham radio. But for now, let me wrap this up. I will not be doing an episode unless something like that comes up pretty soon with those folks. I'll not be doing another episode real quick because I do have to do the Kickstarter legwork to find more people to support it. There's still some video left from Dayton, way back at Dayton in May, that I need to edit because there's some good stuff left over from that, a couple more shows. And then who knows what else. So plenty of ham radio now coming up. And you know, things get really slow, I'll pull out the field day stuff and get that put together. But things never get really slow. I forgot how to end the show. The prop department went nuts. They screwed up a little bit because they made the phony cover sheet just a little bit too big. This book is, there we go, Video and Television Engineering. I don't think I've ever cracked it. I mean, it's How to Produce Ham Radio Now for Dummies. A lot of phony dummies books have been produced, or at least covers. Show close. Say who your guest was. No guest, just me. Yeah, Kay Craigie was on there for a second. Say who you are. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Introduce Arvin. Sitting back there. This is not one of the shows that probably gets you all excited about making a contribution, but should you enjoy this and you haven't contributed lately, I've been getting some awesome contributions. I mean, several hundred dollars, several individual $100 contributions. I got some good email from one guy who sent that. Let me take a moment to take a look at that. This is from Jerry, WB0DEK. And again, Jerry had made a $100 contribution to Ham Radio Now, which is fairly unusual. It's not unheard of. There's probably 15 or 20 people who have done that. But it, you know, it doesn't happen very often. It's notable. And so I asked him how he heard about it and what made the program that valuable to him. And I thought I'd share a little bit of that. He found out about Ham Radio Now from a posting on QRZ.com. And he enjoyed the variety and quality of the content of the videos centered on ham radio. Hopes I can continue doing it for a long time to come. Watched about 30 or 40 of them so far, and he's still working on it. Let's see, what did he like? Particularly the Amsterdam Island Wake DX Atoll, Wake Atoll De-Expeditions. He liked those a lot. Some of the technical stuff. So he likes going to things in that direction. Wouldn't have been able to go to Dayton, so he likes the stuff there. And here's my favorite part. In my opinion, you have the best ham radio programming out there, leagues ahead of Ham Nation. Okay. And other ham radio programming. Not to take away from those programs, but he likes to watch one that is more thorough and focused on a specific subject rather than being brief and general, which is, you know, kind of like what I've been, it turns out I've been doing. I'm not sure that was total accident, but it's this program is not like that. But most of the programs tend to be single subject or at least kind of going in depth on things that nobody else gets to do. And I do get complaints from people that want to watch a 3-minute show. There's plenty of other 3-minute shows to watch. So this is where you get the details. As I was looking for that email, I found one more thing that is important to show. And this is from Bruce Perrins, K6BP, about the Tapper deal. And he managed to get it on Slashdot, which could be very good. Let me take a look and see if I can find the Slashdot. This may be an exercise in futility. Let's find out. Live online stuff. Clearly not right on the front page. Maybe there's a search. This looks like it. Yes, indeed. So we're on Slashdot. I don't know how many people are going to see it. 15 people have made comments so far. Here's a good one. Last time I had a professional video produced, I paid $5,000 for a 1-minute commercial, and those were rock-bottom prices. Yeah, the $8,000 for doing a 3-day conference, that's really kind of a bargain. So anyway, that's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Thank you, Bruce. I guess I'll make you my guest from Slashdot. And everybody else, Kate Craigie showed up on a brief video, and we will see you at the Tapper Conference, if the Kickstarter is successful. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. I got to get out of here. Over and out.